Yes, the relay on YouTube. Check it out. Lots of stories about me on there. All the boxing facts and info that you want in a very entertaining, educational manner. The relay. Check it out on YouTube.
Welcome to the motherfucking relay, where we're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, we'll start with this. Terrence Crawford had this to say. He says, Mean Machine, Jeff Lynn,
yeah.
Jose Benavidez would have given PBC welterweights hell. He was quoted as saying, in my own defense, I would say Mean Machine, Jeff Horn, and Benavidez. There wasn't no B-level fighters in my eyes.
Fuck that shit.
You know, I feel you can put any one of those fighters up against any of those PBC fighters, and they'll give them hell, you know? And especially Benavidez. When you look at Benavidez, what he's been through since he was a kid. Yeah, he got shot in the leg, and everybody wanted to use that as an excuse at the end. Before the fight, he clearly said, my leg is good. I'm not going to use this as an excuse. I've been doing everything going in. And he just came off two stoppage wins. Nobody, not one time, said anything about his leg in those two fights. Leading up to the fight, they just said he got shot in the leg. They never said, oh, we'll see how his leg holds up. And he's not walking funny. He don't have no limp. No, none of that. So once I knock him out, then that's the big topic. Oh, he's got one leg. Oh, this and all that. So that really pissed me off. Jeff Horn, they say, all right, he got cheated by Pacquiao. When you watch the fight, Jeff Horn bullied Pacquiao, you know? Even if he did, you know? Some illegal tactics, or he hit him with elbows or headbutts or whatever the case may be. He did what he had to do to win the fight. You know, it's a fight at the end of the day. When you look at that fight, he took Pacquiao through hell, you know? Pushed him around, bullied him. He made it a rough fight for Pacquiao. And you can't say that fight wasn't close, you know? At the end of the day, and for me to go in there and stop that man that Pacquiao couldn't stop and beat him every round, you don't give me no credit for that. So then you look at Kavalyauskas, you know? Undefeated fighter, a two-time Olympian, you know? Never tasted the canvas, amateur or pro. You know, for me to go out there and stop him in the fashion that I did, you know, you don't want to give me no credit. Y'all say, oh, he was a bum because of his fight with Sugar Ray Robinson. Well, styles make fights, you know. Everybody's not going to have an A-plus night on fight night. Styles make fights, and I give him credit. He's a good fighter, you know. And when you look at Amir Khan, nobody never outboxed Amir Khan. Nobody. When you see Amir Khan close, you see him get knocked out, you know. I was outboxing him from round one to round five till I got the stoppage. So, you know, everybody says, oh, well, Amir Khan, he's done. He's washed up. He's this. He's that. Why can't you just say Terrence Crawford is a great A-level where, you know, he makes these fighters look that way? You know what I think? I think that Terrence Crawford's been watching the fucking relay. He must. It's either that or great minds think alike. Because I've been saying this for the longest fucking time. Way before Terrence Crawford spoke to whoever he spoke to and made these fucking comments. That Igas Kavalyauskas,
that guy,
Jose Benavidez, and yes, Jeff Horn. They probably give those PBC guys a better run for their money than you care to realize. Than you care to acknowledge. We live in an era of boxing to where the fight fans' own ignorance is used against them, to where they're told that because they're not familiar with a fighter, that means the fight is no fucking good.
Without a comprehensive study.
We live in an era of boxing where an Errol Spence can go 12 rounds with a blown-up lightweight. And because the blown-up lightweight happens to have some marquee value, because he has a familiar name,
no one notices.
We live in an era of boxing where it's grossly overlooked that there's no reason this lightweight should go 12 rounds with Errol Spence. There's just no reason for it. This lightweight is vastly unprepared for this fight. He's never fought up here before.
Couldn't stop him.
So why couldn't Big Bad Errol stop him? Got a guy like Danny Garcia. He's going 12 rounds with an Ivan Redcatch. A guy who got stopped by John Molina below 147. A guy who got stopped by Dejan Zlatigini below 147. Nobody bats a fucking eyelash. Nobody says nothing.
Nada.
If in your mind's eye, you don't see what's wrong there. Keith Thiemann, he has a tune-up fight. He barely makes it out alive of the tune-up fight. The tune-up fight he had with Josecito Lopez. I reiterate, if in your mind's eye, you look at this and you don't see what's wrong there.
Can't you see what's going on?
Let me tell you something. You put that same Igas Kavalyauskas in there that Crawford stopped with one of those guys. You put that same Jose Benavidez that Crawford stopped in there with one of those guys. And I guarantee you they give them a run for their money. And it's for this reason that the PBC isolates themselves from everyone else. So they don't end up in those situations.
That's why.
You're living in a bubble. If you think that a Danny Garcia would handle either Jose Benavidez or Aegis Kavalyauskas-Easy. This guy couldn't stop Ivan Redcatch, so he's gonna stop two guys bigger than him?
Yeah, right!
You got a bunch of dime store Ray Arcells who don't know a right cross from a fucking crosswalk, telling themselves that because the PBC stable of welterweights are more familiar, they have more familiar names, that makes them better fighters by default.
Oh, does it?
When, in truth, I'm not convinced that Keith Thurman could contain a mean machine, an Aegis Kavalyauskas. I'm not convinced that he'd look good against a Jose Benavidez. And the same applies to a Danny Garcia. A Danny Garcia who spent his last two fights fighting guys that normally campaign below 147 pounds. There's a reason you're fighting those kinds of guys instead of what other welterweights are out there. And it's a myth that since Terence Crawford ascended to the welterweight division, his quality of competition has been piss poor. Nothing could be further from the truth. Those guys that he's been fighting, Jeff Horn, Aegis Kavalyauskas, Jose Benavidez, those are more solid guys than either an Adrian Granados, an Ivan Redcatch, Rojasito Lopez. Yeah, Keith Thurman, he did end up fighting Manny Pacquiao, but he ended up losing to Manny Pacquiao, didn't he? So that don't strengthen his argument, does it? You look like shit against the Josecito Lopez, and you lose to what is a 41-year-old Manny Pacquiao. And it's not because Manny found the fountain of youth. It's because you and your other stablemates are regressing. You got too accustomed to lighter touches. You got too accustomed to picking and choosing who it is you're going to fight, to the point to where a guy like an Aegis Kavalyauskas, or a guy like a Jose Benavidez, or a guy like a Jeff Horn, I dare say, might give you a harder fight than you or your sycophant fans realize. You'll never put it to the test. And this regression ain't limited to what's going on at 147. I mean, look at what happened to Adam Kovnatsky in the heavyweight division. He goes balls to the wall with a Chris Areola, a fight that should have been an easy tickover. Instead, they end up breaking the record for the most punches thrown in a heavyweight contest. I think it was lost on a lot of people that Adam should have been able to wrap up Chris rather conveniently, but he didn't, so that he could go into a fight with a Robert Hellenius and get stopped. This is regression, folks. This is what happens when a fighter is asleep at the wheel and he's not sharp as he could be, as sharp as he should be. Guys like Aegis Kavalyauskas and Jose Benavidez and Jeff Horn, to a lesser extent, those guys are banana peels.
That's what they are.
Oh, they're not your A++ fighters, but they're not the kind of fighters that you can afford to look over. You give those guys half an opportunity, they're gonna capitalize on it. And those ain't the kind of fighters that your PBC stable of welterweights, those ain't the kind of fighters that they like to keep busy with. There's a reason for it. So when I hear Terence Crawford
saying what he's saying,
I know exactly what he's talking about because I said it and have been saying it long before he said it, long before he noticed it. You know, you go telling yourself that Aegis Kavalyauskas ain't a good fighter because you never heard of him before, Jose Benavidez. But who was Emmanuel Navarrete before he beat the brakes off of Isaac Dogbe? Who was Jaime Munguia before he bounced Saddam Ali off the canvas?
Did you know?
Don't go thinking that because you're not familiar with a guy, that guy's no good, because maybe you're not familiar with him because you don't know what the fuck you're talking about half the time. You let the promoters tell you who's a good fighter and who ain't a good fighter. You let them convince you of who's good and who ain't. The networks, the managers, the guys calling a fight. You let them make the decision for you as to whether or not you think a fighter is a good fighter. That's why you watch Errol Spence go 12 rounds with Mikey Garcia and you don't bat a fucking eyelash. That's why you watch Danny Garcia go 12 rounds with an Ivan Redcatch and it doesn't even dawn on you that he just went 12 rounds with Ivan Redcatch. Ivan couldn't go 12 rounds with John Molina or Dejan Slatigini, so what's that say about Danny when he goes 12 rounds with him? That's right. You guys, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. I mean, for Christ's sakes, whenever Danny Garcia's brought up, all these guys can talk about is how he beat Amir Khan and Lucas Matisse years ago, but that was years ago. What's he done for me lately? The bottom line here is that some of Terence Crawford's opponents are actually a lot more solid than people realize, and the reason that they don't know any better is because of the PBC's island policy.
They don't want to know.
In heavyweight news, Marcellus Wilder, the younger brother of Deontay Wilder, I'm sure most of you have heard by now, is doing what he can to keep the Glovegate conspiracy alive with a recent post that he made on Instagram that reads, "You know it's crazy when you're great? They gotta do everything that's underneath real to figure out how to stop you. And the most wicked shit about is..."
What?
Okay.
Huh?
"People on your own team will do anything for the hate, money, to help them ops take you down. It was discovered by doctors that my brother has a dent in the side of his head due to a blunt object struck against his head from his last fight. No glove or fist was able to cause the damage, according to the autopsy.
Autopsy?
Filed to die?
Wait a minute.
My daddy once told me if you pull a gun out on somebody, you better kill them, because if you don't, they're gonna come back and kill you. King is about to rise again. We're coming for blood.
Your daddy told you that.
Your daddy should have told you what an autopsy is, because unless Wilder was a corpse at the time the doctor saw him, I don't know what kind of fucking autopsy you're talking about.
Now, as you can imagine, there are those out there that are going to use Marcellus Wilder's recent comments as a means to lend further credence to the notion that Tyson Fury had something inside of his gloves. They were loaded with what? We don't know. But it's clear that there are those out there, a minority,
few guys,
that feel that Tyson Fury tampered with his gloves. The story originally was that he tampered with his gloves, took the padding out so that it would be a bare fist inside of the glove. Now the story is that there was some kind of metal object,
the Infinity Gauntlet,
inside of the glove. And this is making news. Not that there was actually a metal object inside of the glove, but that Marcellus Wilder is saying these things, making these allegations, accusations against Tyson Fury. Though then, like now, this ain't getting off the ground, because if there were any truth to what is being said, we wouldn't be hearing about a tight fight between Tyson Fury and Deontay Wilder. We'd be hearing about court proceedings for attempted murder. Look, my thoughts on this haven't changed. If what Marcellus Wilder and Wilder's fans were saying were true, and it could be proven, which is essentially what Marcellus is saying.
Yeah, via the autopsy.
Then we wouldn't be hearing about a third fight. What we'd be hearing about is charges being levied against Tyson Fury for attempted murder. Marcellus Wilder is trying to keep this conspiracy theory, because that's what it is at this point. It's still just a theory until proven otherwise. Marcellus is trying to keep this theory alive, and several YouTube authors are trying to keep this theory alive. Though, with them, their reasons for being proponents of this theory is a little bit more obvious, a little bit more transparent.
Bro, the money keep coming in. What can I say? I'm rich, bitch! No, I'm just playing. But we do well for ourselves. Let's just say that. Listen, this gonna be over $200 stream. We right there. Keep sending your money, send me your stimulus checks. Another over $200 stream back to back. Who else in boxing is doing it like me? That's what I thought. So bow down to something greater than yourself, fool. Listen.
These bums, these YouTube panhandlers, play up this angle, play up this story, because they know that there are people out there that want to hear this, even if there isn't a shred of evidence to corroborate it. That if it were true, that this could be proven, that Wilder was struck with a blunt force object that caused damage to him that could only be caused by a blunt force object, we'd be hearing about a court battle.
Not a boxing match.
If you don't like this, I don't care. So you can leave your comments about me just being a Wilder lover and all that stuff. You can take it and you can shove it. Yeah. I do not care. Yeah. Because I am now not just leaning to believe that Tyson Fury is one of the biggest scumbags that has ever walked in a boxing ring, and the people around him are the biggest scumbags to ever walk in a boxing ring. Deontay Wilder's injuries as a result, and I'm sure Blue Blood covered this in a video a while ago. I know that other people have made, you know, they've talked about it, but personally, I never wanted to get into it because I know the type of reaction that you get when you say things like this. I know it. I've gotten hate from AJ fans. I've gotten hate from Tyson Fury fans. I know what it is. And every once in a while, dude, you just want to say, okay, we got the fight and the next fight's going to come and we'll see what happens in the next fight. But after a conversation that I had, I cannot do that. I cannot take the angle that I'm just going to wait until the next fight comes up and then we'll see the, Deontay Wilder, we'll see how the second fight winds up and all that. No. Because Tyson Fury tried to kill Deontay Wilder in that ring, in my opinion.
And that is how you can skip out on reconciling what it is you're saying. That's how you do it. That's how you get around that. You just say that it's your opinion, thus it doesn't have to be proven. You don't have to make sense of it when it's just your opinion. That's how you can get away with making these kinds of accusations in the absence of concrete evidence, so that you can assign guilt at your leisure. Tyson Fury had a checkered past before he ever threw a punch.
at Deontay Wilder, you understand. And that didn't seem to bother these guys ahead of the first fight and ahead of the second fight. They weren't worried about Tyson Fury's checkered past, his Nandrolone case, the fact that he had Daniel Kinahan in his corner. None of this seemed to bother them. It only bothered them after Wilder lost the fight. And that's the nature of the problem. That is the nature of their problem. It's not Tyson Fury's checkered past that bothers them. It's that Wilder lost the fight.
That's what they're mad about.
Tyson Fury didn't start having a checkered past as soon as he fought Deontay Wilder. That Nandrolone case goes back years. And they never brought it up. Not ahead of the first fight. Not ahead of the second fight. And Daniel Kinahan has been in Tyson Fury's corner for a while now. I mean, he's not there anymore.
Supposedly.
But when he first came back, when he decided to return to boxing, Daniel Kinahan was there. And I reiterate, that didn't bother these guys. You didn't hear them complaining about who he rubs elbows with. That only became an issue after he got his ass beat. So as far as why is it that the YouTube authors are so choosing to be proponents of this conspiracy theory? Well, that's a little bit more obvious.
Money.
It's because they want to continue to capitalize on it. It's because they are butthurt that their favorite fighter, their pony in the show, their favorite heavyweight, Deontay Wilder, was embarrassed on his own soil by Tyson Fury, who they thought was a feather-fisted pillow puncher. They never in a million years, while advocating for this fight, pushing for it, they never in a million years thought that Tyson Fury was going to go out there and knock Deontay Wilder out. That's their angle. Marcellus's angle, Wilder's brother, that's a little different. That requires reconciliation, because if Marcellus Wilder truly believes that these men tried to kill his brother, then shouldn't they be pursuing legal action? I mean, what's the plan here? You're saying that the deck was so stacked against your brother,
right,
that not only was he struck with a metal object in the midst of the fight, but before that, they had an inside man on his team. There was a mole working with the Tyson Fury camp. And your plan moving forward is to have Wilder fight Tyson Fury again?
What?
Am I understanding this? You're saying that your brother was struck with a metal object, and you can prove this via a medical examiner due to his autopsy of Wilder, because Wilder's dead. And what dead Wilder is going to do, his plan of action moving forward, is to have another fight with Tyson Fury where he has the evidence to take him to court, sue him for millions, jail him for attempted murder.
Because you can prove this.
Moles on the inside, metal objects inside the gloves, strychnine in the water. You have corroborating evidence that substantiates all sorts of claims. And rather than using that evidence to levy
court case,
a case against Tyson Fury, what you're going to do is send Wilder in there to fight him again so that the same thing can happen again? Because this is what you're saying happened. And if you're not going to go through the proper channels to seek justice to ensure that this doesn't happen to you or anyone else again, likelihood, since that's not what you're doing, it's going to happen again to your brother. And this is your plan. Well, you know, what can I expect from a guy who doesn't know what a fucking autopsy is, right?